I invited Andrea Murnik. He is from Italy, from Milano. Andrea, he was a gallerist. He had one very important and famous gallery in Milano. And later she decided to stop with the gallery and she became a researcher. Andrea is a researcher. And today he will speak about his state.
Okay.
You remember that we were speaking a little bit about research and Andrea prepared a workshop, a lecture, or what?
Just a lecture.
A lecture about his state. So?
My turn.
You can start.
Okay.
Maybe you can. Present your project NisemTu. He's been working on project NisemTu for many years, so maybe some shortly that it will be like a starting point and later we can come.
Yeah, let's say that NisemTu is a network of researchers. I'm the leader, but there are many. What is it?
This?
Yeah.
No problem.
And use this. There are mostly here or in Italy, but also in other countries around the world, in Canada and Spain and other places. And we are attending to research that is now not so specific for our meeting, but the general matter is researching on methodology of creativity, how to manage the creativity. Because of this reason, we cover.
Just a moment, I think it would be great that if you take a paper and maybe you write some or something, it's good because later you will forget,
This is good idea also because I will give you. This is a little different way of taking a lecture for the NisemTu system because normally it's based on a. Didactic method that is proper to NisemTu. But in this case, I normally use videos, pictures, videos, and other two elements that are, of course, talking about theories and performing. Now, in this case, we have no videos and we have very few performances, so we not have any stuff to remember everything, and maybe we will put some things. And then maybe also we can perform it right. Inside this group of researchers, we are covering a lot of different fields, different matters. Art was the starting point, but then we are covering astrophysics, like biochemistry, like psychology under many different aspects of neuropsychology and so on, so different fields. Nowadays we came, exactly the last year, we came to some solution after 40 years of research, so it was a kind of very topic moment for us to celebrate because finally we had an answer. I want to tell you something that is important in case you will miss something from this apparently from this lecturing, that we never are, it is forbidden in NisemTu to answer to why. We answer to how. We are interested in how things work and not why they are working. Some way. Of course, why inside the how it is allowed, obviously, but the big why, so why this world exists and so on, this is completely out from our matter and our intentions, and we have a total 100% scientific approach to everything. No spiritualism, new age, or every kind, or intuition, or energy, so vibrations are all words that have no meaning for us. So, being to the subject of today, this is also a kind of a very final point. It is a consequence of what we fixed the last year. And many years long already here in Tefura, I was talking about mistaking two or 3 years ago, if I remember, when it was open in the university.
Andrea had a workshop with
but also in the no, it was in the this lecture for free university.
Yeah, like this, but first you had a workshop, 3 days workshop. It was 3 days.
Workshop here was
yeah, 3 or 4 days.
2 days. We cleaned them in 2 days. Ah, 18 okay. hours in 2 days.
Okay, yeah, we started at 9 in the morning and we finished at 7, 8 in the evening. And it was really good experience for students. Huh?
Who survived?
Yeah.
Intense.
Huh?
Intense.
Yeah, very intense, yeah. And later you had a lecture in this week of university. Yeah, this was
and this was so we already 2-3 years ago we mm-hmm. we were on stage about meaning of mistake and so on, and also before of course. But now we have some conclusion. So let's say that when I was a gallerist, that was in when the dinosaurs just dead, so just immediately after many years ago, I was popular, as Elena said, and because of this, each day I was getting a lot of brochure, catalogs, decals, pictures, books, and calls, of course, and everything. So each day there was such an amount of books to see. And of course I was a private gallerist, so I was not paid for making other things that my job that was selling, promoting artists and selling art. And I knew by experience immediately that it was quite impossible that something really interesting would come. But I wanted to be correct, so I was watching all of them always, in the beginnings alone, then I had my assistants, they were filtering a little bit. But I got some criteria for being quick, because I was spending 40 minutes every morning for this, not an hour, so quickly I had to decide if somebody was sufficiently interesting to say, look, you are not maybe interesting for me, but you are. And if you want to meet, we can meet, but don't expect an exhibition or something like that, but we can talk. And so the first thing they was watching was the curriculum. Of course, this was not for young artists. But even a young artist, after 2-3 steps, you can already understand if he was well-oriented in his, if he was selecting exhibitions, if he was choosing the right ones or not. Maybe mistaken, but you could see a criteria. But the second step was watching the pictures, of course, the images inside the catalog. And I was watching them from the end to the beginning, not from the beginning to the end. Because I was looking for mistakes. Normally, in a catalog, if you are not such a popular artist or such an important artist, but even an important artist that is making a solo exhibition, he puts the not so successful pieces, not so convincing pieces at the end. Because, of course, normally we read from the first and we say, oh, wow, this is strong. Oh, this is a, and then the last, okay, we already can tolerate this. But this is, if you are a collector, or if you are judging from buying or for getting something, if you need just to evaluate how serious, how good he is, how rich is his character, so it's good to look for mistakes. Because if you are not researching, you are not making mistakes. So if there were mistakes, these mistakes could be of two kinds, of course. Pure mistakes, just a mistake, or especially watching the pieces before to say, oh, he was trying to do this or trying to solve this and he didn't succeed, but he was trying. And this was making my opinion positive for the character of the person, of course, of the artist, because he was not making what is done today, for instance. No artist today is mistaken. Everybody is just making correct. Because it's very easy, if you are on the surface, to make things correct. I can also make. I have sufficient experience to make pieces of art, so-called pieces of art that are not pieces of art, but pieces for the market of art. Pieces of art, a piece of art has something else. So, about mistaking, did you ever consider how important is the presence of mistaking in your life? Did you ever consider how it is driving your life, mistaking or not mistaking? The consideration that few people make, it is that what is taught to you in the school, when you started with elementary school and then 13 years long, you were making some tests, then red and blue pencil, they were making okay, red pencil, half a note less, blue pencil, one note less, and then mathematically this is your notes. And so if you were smart enough, you understood that was you were expected not to mistake. And if you were very, very clever, maybe you were not studying so much, but you were just playing not to mistake, just making what they wanted. So no creativity. You are taught in the school not to be creative, not to have any courage, just try to obey to the rules that are these. Of course, these rules are important. You have to write correctly. But this happens already in the school, but then even also in the universities, not every faculty, not certainly this classroom. I don't say for compliment, but I know that it's not this the case. But for sure, you have many other professors that the most part of professors, they don't accept that you are making something original, strange, coming out from the views. And if you are mistaking, and let's say also, you can also maintain the logic of what you are doing to say, look, but this, okay, it's not what you were asking for. But my logic was this. I was trying to make this for this way. Maybe it was wrong. Maybe I'm not even satisfied, but I'm following this way. And the answer normally is no, you have to do what I tell you to. So be inside the walls of the rules. And you will, and again, you are confirmed what you learn in the school, make what they ask you and you will have a diploma. Otherwise you will have a diploma but with a lot of troubles more. And when you come out from the university and start your work, your life, working life, oh, this is also more. You are working in a shop, in an office, or in another place, if you are not self-employed, but even self-employed, you know, taxes and everything, they're telling you must, these are the rules. Well, Italian is a very good language because comes from Latin, you know, it helps a lot, because in English we say rules, or laws. In Italian, rules are norma, is norma. So norma, from norma comes normal. So if you are normal, if you are applying the rules. If you are not applying the rules, you are abnormal, and you are in prison, or you are isolated from the society, put in condition not to communicate with the society because you are dangerous for the society, in the opinion of society. So maybe you are, really you are, but in some cases you are just trying to find new ways. And of course to find new ways you have to research, you have to try, you have to put a lot of courage in things and you have consequently you mistake a lot. So must be clear that views are useful. It's better not to cross the street if there is the red light, otherwise it's very possible that you will die. But we have a peculiar characteristic as human beings that we are both social and individual animals. inside the same mind and body. This means that we are, till we are in the society, we know the rules, we apply the rules, we have a quiet life. If we are not applying, we know that we will not have a quiet life, maybe more exciting, more beautiful, but we know that we will have some troubles because of the society. But when we are inside ourselves, all these rules of the society, the most part, are not our rules. You're a child, and your mother says, say thanks to the person that gave the present. Say hello, you must say dober dan, dobro jutro. And you would just say, fuck you. You know? So, but you cannot. But inside yourself, what you really are, it is the fuck you.
Yeah.
It's not hello, dober dan. No? And if you're watching your life now, always, every minute, what is inside yourself is not corresponding, in the most part of cases, with what society is telling you to do. But it is correct, I repeat, it is very correct to obey to the views of the society, of course. Not only to have a quiet life, but also to have a safe life. A society is made to protect ourselves, to support each other. So, and we must have compromises that are general compromises. Then there is a special society that is made by two people, no? Marriages, for instance, or two people living together in a house. In this case, it's a 50-50. So if I am in society, if I am in Slovenia, I know that I have to drive right. Because in Slovenia, you must drive right. 2 million people are telling me, you must drive right. But if I am with just one other person, we have to decide which is the rule, mine or his, or hers. And normally there is a compromise that is not making happy anybody. And long-term life, this is normally destroying the relation. But we are not such interested in this. We are interested in the fact that as an artist, as a producer or a designer, as a creative person, you are... you need to apply your rules that are not the social rules, that are not the normal rules. You have to be, you are taught to be original, but originality is a little dangerous word. Maybe we will come back after to this point. You should be something more. We will see what I mean with this. So, I cannot say fuck you to everybody I would like, so I hide it. And we hide the most part of our thoughts. We have something that is showing our thoughts. If we are a little naive, we are not experienced, we show our reactions and everybody is saying, oh, you must not think this, oh. If we are expert, we are very able to hide it, till a politician, you know, or a pope, or king, you know, they are not moving. Pay attention, the politician is moving, controlling movements, even a pope, even a king. But normally when they are sitting, they are just standing, the face has no expression. And they are controlling this, that is a terrible job, you know. They really have to learn this, because all of us, we need to express ourselves. Their main reason, it is ancestral reason, it is that we need to communicate. And before the word, before there were words and sounds, before we were using sounds for communicating, we could communicate only with our behavior, with our position of our body, with some little sign. So we have thousands of these signs. When you are a child, what is you are when we were children, which was our interest. We had two interests, not to avoid pain and to search for pleasure. All the rest was not consistent for us. But when we felt pain, we started to cry. Then parents learned, oh, baby's crying, he has pain, let me see, I have to clean his ass, I have to give him food, feed him, or what else. If he's smiling, oh, he's happy. And these are expressions of emotions. These are called proto-emotions. It is pain and pleasure are proto-emotions, and we express in this way. But then, within 6 years, they teach you, don't cry, stop to cry. You have not to cry. Don't show that you don't become red. Don't become angry. Don't shake your body. Don't compress your emotions. Don't show them. So we learn not to show the emotions, but this doesn't mean that we have not inside. We have anyway inside, and it doesn't mean that we don't show. We don't show them in such an expressive way. We show through small movements, so you can easily, immediately understand if something is aggressive or not. For instance, if I do so probably you jumped, you did, you said, what is happening? But how much time you had to think about this? Nothing. So your reaction was before I was throwing the ball, before the ball came. Your reaction was, I defend myself, I don't, before. So the same with emotions. Our emotions are inside us, and we show them without thinking, before thinking. If you are very able, you can see this. And this, this is such important? Because this is the only... Emotions are the words of expression through people, because we are all individuals, as we said, we are isolated inside ourselves, we have our own reactions in front of things, but we are living in society. So how can I, as an artist, as a creator, as a designer, communicate with others? Which is the common field? Which is our language? I can be tricky. I can convince through marketing systems, through way of convincing people, through actions and shapes that and colors and so on. But if I really want to communicate something that is really catching, the only way is speaking the same language, that is through the word of emotion. So I have to express my emotions, the same emotions that I. Oh, can you give me back this, or you take this board, please, you take it, then we will use again. So this is clear, this point. If I'm too speed, I'm compressing a lot of information, but you stop me, please. How can we... solve this problem, because compressing our emotions, the risk or the certainty is to become neurotic, of course. All of us, we are neurotic because we cannot express what we really feel, what we really are. And so Freud says, oh, it's so easy. Sublimation. You want to kill, you are aggressive, okay, make the boxer, or make the soldier, or so. But this is somehow strange also from Freud, because it is the straight way to psychosis, because psychosis is, every kind of psychosis is defined when you change the object. You are interested, you should be interested, your object should be this, but you put another object instead of this. So, if I am interested, if I want to make something, I must make that thing. But society is not allowing me. So how? So this, we have this trouble. All of us, all humanity, always had this trouble inside. So sublimation is not such a good solution. We are in NisemTu. We consider that there are. We have other ways. One interesting point is that all of us, we have the same secret. All of us, we know that we are saying fuck you to a lot of people, that we want to kill children, that that are just disturbing, that this is just our impulse, is just that. Then we don't do it because society is forbidding it. And so, consequently, we also come till the point to believe that we, this is our character, but if you just mirror us, we see that we are not that, we are kind of monsters, that we do not be accepted by the society. But when you are very open to, with yourself, and everybody is open, you, who is looking at your product is open, saying, then he said, oh, we are both two monsters, so this is a secret that we both have. And so if we are so many monsters, maybe there are no monsters. This is normal. Maybe abnormality is not to be a monster. This is just a logic consequence. But just to let you understand that all of us, we have this in common. We have a secret inside. So we have a common base of communicating. That is through our attitudes, emotions, and when we can express something in through drawing or through our products, that is sincere, that is exactly what we are. There are, in art, we are in NisemTu, we are distinguishing four categories, but this can be applied also to fashion design, of course. It is true, fake, false, and there is not an English translation, let's say, false and bad made. So if you are making a product of yours, and this is just the truth, I tell you, look, you have not to produce it, you could write me a phrase and tell me this truth. It is not, was not needed. Inside the localization of art or fashion design system we are putting inside this, you need something else. You need ambiguity, you need to blink your eyes to me to say, look Andrea, you see, this is the trick, you know? Maybe with some irony and playing with some syntactic. And this makes it fake. That means it is not the truth, but inside this localization is the real thing. It is what we really need. No golden Madonna or no Leonardo's or no Madonna or no Michelangelo's shape was as a man. They were physically monsters. This is blinking, you know, to say, okay, I know. Do you want to show you that I'm able? I'm able. But I'm making it this way because I want to tell you more. I want to say you what I have inside. That is the same that you have. So just very, very shortly, and then we come straight to the question of mistaking. You must consider one thing. Okay, maybe we can... You want to use this? But I am such a bad drawer. So we have our universe that is made by a lot of data. For instance, just to say one photon. So and here is my eye, and I'm getting this data inside my eye. Everybody of you know how many data each second I'm getting. Have you any idea? Or how many photons? So I have 126 millions of receptors here for this data, and I am emitting 11 millions of information for each data back to my nerve. That makes a number that is 1,360,000 billions of giga. Such an hour, each second. And then it crosses our skull, our brain, and here in the occipitalis part, there is where I get finally these data. You know how many of these data they come here per second? 40. There is something strange, no? So I have this number that I cannot repeat, 1,360,000 billions of giga of data coming here, and only 40 they come to my brain, only 40 come to microsigns. Here one thing happens, that we transform this, I don't know which number, let's say that probably we transform them in something like 4 million. These 40, they become 4 billion, let's say, I don't know. We fill the holes. We put what is logic for us, we put in. And this makes the difference of my reality from each other realities. We are individuals because of... we are individuals because we are filling these holes in our way, for our intentions, for what is our brain scientists is useful for. But okay, but still, what happens here? Here, where these data, they cross, here we are studying a lot on this. Here, we call, this is a invention of NisemTu, there is the ego sapiens. The ego sapiens is that one that, if I throw a ball, decides if it is dangerous or not, before the information comes here. And that's you react, goes to the muscles down, and lets you react automatically to this. But also makes another thing, it produces emotions. That, be careful, emotions are here inside. When they come outside, they become feelings. Or what in English is called emotion. But it's not a correct word. Emotions are producing something. As an artist, as a producer, you must be able to talk with the ego sapiens. You must, to be sincere, what you are, really, which is producing your fuck you or love you, it is here inside. It is just a reaction, and of course, it's hidden to yourself. You know only what is here. You know how much of brain we have, all the cortex, how much it is. It is 3 millimeters by 60 by 80 centimeters. This is all of our knowledge and our brain, our logic and so on. All the rest, that is 300 billions of times more cells. We don't know how we use them exactly. We know something. So here is produced in these billions of cells. It is produced your reaction. And if you want to talk about yourself, you must talk. You cannot straight talk because you don't know. You cannot. Also, ego sapiens is our invention. It's not a physiological or psychological figure, it is a character, it is just something that we are using for having the idea was what is happening. Now, I would like to make this, now you all together, now you will be so able to please to pronounce what you are reading here. all together, please.
And up.
Yeah.
Up.
Up.
Okay. No, this is interesting question. It is very important question. You know? Okay, let's say Suvi. Ah, you already. What happened in your brain? So this is a visual information data that came inside and became a sound. What are you so able? Somebody is. Are you so able to remember or try again? Are you seeing a or a in your brain, or are you listening it, or both maybe? Before producing the sound.
Both.
Well, could be both. Normally it's both. And of course the contrary. If I say ah, then I say please can you show me ah? You draw your ah. So what is happening in our brain? It is called tote. It is test. Externalization and observation. So the A that was visual and it was external, this came into your brain, and your brain was made, produced a visual internal, maybe also hearing it still internal, and then compared these two R with the prototype of R that has already inside third. Without this, there is no knowledge. We learn by experience, as we know.
Could you repeat once more?
Is it complete?
We
of course. So, maybe I'm sorry because I used A and this is confusing. A is also audition.
Mm-hmm.
So. So if I am driving, so making visual this and it is external to your brain, then comes in. And when it comes in, you are elaborating it. And you are elaborating, as we said, one or two ways, depends. Normally you repeat the figure, so you are visualizing inside in your brain. And probably, most part of cases, you are also listening. And so the A becomes also audition inside. This is clear. And then,
yeah.
What are you doing with this couple? Could be also much more complicated. I make it as simple as possible. It is much more complicated. And then you make a comparison with this letter A that you already have inside yourself, that you already learned when you were a baby and when you were in the school. You were taught that A is A, A is A, E is E. And it has this representation, this and that. And then you compare it. And you say, okay, second test, I'm making this test, and then you say, okay, it's correct, okay. Okay. Right, but if it is not, then you have to repeat. Then you enter into another total and you repeat the same. And you repeat, till the moment it comes back and say, okay. This is for a very, apparently very, is it clear? If it is not, please stop me because this is a little topic point. Is it clear? Where's the ball? Now, can you put the ball on your hand? And then can you stand and turn around and bring me, please?
Just
as you like. Just to bring me. Your goal is to bring me the ball in this way. Okay, thank you. Now, inside this system, how many of these operations we made? The goal is go to Andrea to give the ball. Take the ball, put in equilibrium on the hands. It's shaking a little. So correct. Continue. Correct. It is. Is the information coming me good or not? No. Oh, make it so. Okay. So maintain this, and then move the legs, arms, breathing, everything. You had millions of these operations just breathing in the ball. This is how we work. How our brain works. You know. To make it more simple, I wanted to be provocative and make immediately some formula, but it is very simple. Consider when you are listening music, and it is the volume is not what you want. What you do? You say, "Oh, I want louder," and you go and you turn. Then it is you are not so precise. You are not a computer. You don't know where exactly you want. You have to judge from listening to it. So you turn a little bit, then you say, no, this is too much. Little much enough? Then, okay, this is correct. You made this operation. Constantly. Reading is the same. Letter by letter, when we were learning, it is the same. Till we have words, if we have full pages, that we can read just in a glance. And what this means? What was your work till me? You had one okay, or a serial okay, but how many errors you had to correct? How many times you had to have equilibrium, to make the step, to decide not to fall down, to put another leg? So how many, so your equilibrium, you know that we walk falling down, you know? And we avoid to fall, put in another leg, otherwise our way of walking is falling down. So if you don't put the other leg, so we feel that equilibrium is now this the moment to put the other leg, and then is the other moment, and so on. So continuously we are making better our errors, our mistakes. There are many more mistakes than right things that we are doing. The right thing is the goal. When we reach the goal, so now to say coming into the research and what you are doing, how to use the mistake as producers, as creative persons, as we said, if you are correct and you're not tricky, you have to research. By definition, researching means mistaking and so on, but what is important that you are expressing exactly what you feel inside, your emotions. If you are just playing tricks, you are a tricky guy. You are making something false. And if you are not able enough, you are making false and bad mate. So this is what you normally see in art. You come into a gallery, a museum, normally there is a selection, but you can distinguish the pieces. And you can immediately, if you give just a panoramic view, you will see immediately which is the piece that has the right light, the right power. It doesn't matter if it is big or small, it is who is heavy, psychologically heavy enough to kill all the other around. And every museum director, if he is not stupid, is setting the world in this way, the important piece and the potatoes and salad around, but the beef that is there, you know? So, and so you can see immediately where is the right piece. And so also in your production, but of course you are too much involved, it's easier to go to Aaron and say what you think about, or to go to another, what you think about. But this is a little risky, you know, because, okay, if it is Elena, she knows what you are doing. If it is me, I don't know. Maybe I'm a football fan and don't know anything about fashion. So I would say, oh, what is this useless thing? This, I don't see the colors are wrong for dressing for a football team. No, this cannot be used. No, it's a very important to understand that localization is nothing universal. Everything has to be put in its own localization. So when you are producing, you have to judge by yourself, but you are a little much too in. But when you will become very experienced, you will also learn to say, by your experience, to say, oh, this works or not. And normally, you have to react like if I throw the ball. This is the trick, the only trick that I can teach you. If you are trying to justify or to explain what you're doing through words, it doesn't work. You must fall in love like with a girl or with a boy. That is, before you decide why you fell in love and so on. So you say, oh, she's the one, he's the one. Oh, I love her. Oh, and then you start to think about, no? So you must be so able, it is very difficult, but then you can reach it. It is not such difficult. You have to reach this mental position to say, forget everything you know. Just answer yourself. Is it okay or not? Just which is the first reaction? And then you work on this, and we see how. So you have two things. One is, so this is a drawing that also put on Facebook. It is made by somebody. I, happiness. Okay? If I put in this way, it looks that so easy. Which is the way to straight way to happiness is that. But in our life, if you consider, we come in and we start to make so many. And many times we come also on this main way, but we go back and we go back. Very difficult that we go just straight. And here also. When you are trying to solve a problem, you are putting over a lot of answers, doubts, hypotheses. And normally the answer is already there. If you clean your mind from all of this, and you are just talking straight with what you are, you straight know the answer, which is the direction to follow. This is a practice that is called Occam's Razor. It was invented in the 13th century by William of Occam. He was a monk, black friar from Ireland, that when he was in Holland, in the Dutch countries, he philosophically produced this formula. So, to solve a problem, everything that is not needed immediately to solve the problem, cut away. This is the formula. Then, for many centuries, this was not really forgotten, but just applied, so, in philosophy. And now it's the main way of scientific research in every field, and not only in scientific research. Every kind of field that is applying research is applying Occam's razor. So go straight to the goal. Don't consider everything that was not needed to solve the problem. Normally we put problems in our life. We put problems. Continuing this, I love her, I want to get married, but, okay, I need a home. And then to have a home, I need a job. To have a job, I need to find a job. To find a job, maybe the job is not forever, and so on, and it's not sufficient money. And we are putting a lot of troubles inside. But which was the question? Shall I marry her or not? The answer is easy. And if you give this answer, everything becomes consequent, not determining your answer. And this was the very dominating answer from William of Occam. Well, to come to the solution that we apply also Occam's razors, but inside a structure, a way of researching that is based on mistakes and serendipity. Who knows what is serendipity? Let's say, I will tell you something now, which is the common, has in common, the discovery of America by Cristoforo Colombo, the discovery of dynamite by Alfred Nobel, discovery of penicillin by Alexander Fleming, the use of LSD, the conditional reflexes of Pavlov's dogs, cellophane, pluribol, Prozac, Teflon, Post-it, microwaves, oven, Velcro, mirror neurons, Viagra, Uranus, X-rays, World Wide Web and Internet. What they have in common? Everybody who knew of you, can you figure out what is this? This thing that all of them they have in common. They were found by case. Who was researching was looking for something else. And then step in these things and say, oh, Viagra typically was a medicine, they were looking for a medicine that was helping the circulation of blood in the heart. And then they discovered that it had also another effect, maybe also better than other medicines for the heart, it had this effect. And Post-it, you know, Post-it, it was a mistake. They wanted to make a very, very strong glue, something that you cannot absolutely unbind. And they were not succeeding. And then they had such a pile of things, and a guy, a worker inside said, oh, this is good to put into the books to know where I can to read, and I can put here and there. And pluribol, you are putting your object inside pluribol, it was cellophane already was a mistake. And then somebody producing cellophane, mistaking the formula, chemical formula, when they press, because cellophane is some layers of plastics that are pressed down. So the chemistry that didn't work already, the press came out and they had all these balls. And again, a worker found all these balls, these sheets of to throw away, and he said, oh, this is so good to pack my thing that I have to change home, you know? And everything, and of course the most famous is America. Cristoforo Colombo was looking for Indians. And here is, I already want to anticipate one point very important. Was Cristoforo Colombo the first to find America? No, it was Eric the Red, Viking, 600 years before. But why we say yes, but who cares? It was Cristoforo Colombo. Because he had something that is mandatory. So all of these discoveries that were made, I was mentioning you, the guy that was researching and found them had the knowledge to say, oh, but this is better. It was not luck. It is, to explain in a funny way what is serendipity, it said I was looking for a needle in the hay grass, and I found the farmer's daughter. That was better. But this is luck. You must, it is not correct. You must know that the second thing is better. So without knowledge, without having studied a lot, without having a full comprehension of all the system, you can meet a lot of these stuffs and never recognize them. You must recognize. And again, Italian Latin helps. You know what means recognition. Cognire means knowing, recognize means known again. So I already know, I just recognize, like a person, oh, I recognize you, yes, we met years ago. So the same here. But you need the knowledge. Without the knowledge, okay, you can be the most lucky person in the world, but luckiest person in the world, but this is not serendipity. Serendipity is a nice story, if you like, because it was a romance written, taken from an old legend in India from the 14th century. In the 16th century, Cristoforo Armeno, that was not at all known Italian writer, wrote the story of these three children of the king of Serendipo that had to make a journey through India, and they had a lot of troubles. But each time they had a trouble, they found something better from these troubles. Something came better from them. So this was all the story. So then Horace Walpole in the 19th century in Great Britain read it and loved this, and he made a promotion of this. And so Serendipity now became in the Anglophonic countries, but now everybody in the, everywhere in the world, a way of thinking and researching. But normally, when you read it, when you see also the movies, there is a movie, Serendipity, that was a blockbuster some few years ago, you see that there is a misunderstanding. It's misunderstood with luck. No. It is, there is a mistake, something that didn't work for what you were expecting in your research. And then you have to decide. 99%, just to say maybe more, of the mistakes are just mistakes. But in 1% of the cases, this mistake can be useful. And can be useful in two ways. Can be useful to solve your problem, helps to solve your problem. Or maybe, if you are very, you have a lot of knowledge and a lot of intelligence and a lot of patience, you see and say, no, this is totally out from this system. But if I put it into another system, this works. So you invent a new theory for another system. So you have these two possibilities. So so what we found, this is a practice that we make, I will tell you, I didn't bring, but you can find also, suppose, online. We had very recently an experience of serendipity that was really exciting for us, because we were making a workshop, 6 days long, very intensive workshop here in Ljubljana, to find some, to learn some things like identification things and so on. And then the final result was a serendipity product, I will tell you. Before, I just wanted to underline the main point that we, to which we came. So it's not, you have not to go around to say, now I will draw something and then okay, then I will find, you must really very inspired. Maybe you can if you don't think sufficient. You don't think at all, maybe. Maybe. Because you are just letting this express directly, you know, some kind of meditation or something like this, but it's not so easy. So when you are applying serendipity, you must consider that you have to be, first of all, curious. You are on that way. I have to go home. And I take my car and just go home. And go just watch the street. And I go home. And what happens in my life, it is that I went from metaphor to home. But if I watch around, if I'm curious, then maybe I see something interesting. Something new, something that gives me something, something that I can apply to what I'm thinking. A person, a bridge, a tree, or something. You know? So curiosity is the first thing that, these are the tendrils, I suppose, 11 rules that we have for Serendipity that I invite you to take note, that you must apply all of them. Then you must be pay attention. 100%, 360 degrees attention. There is something that I cannot show you here, but if you come to some workshop of ours, we can sometimes be sure. You know, it's true that you see 360 degrees around. Because you are watching me, you cannot know what is in this moment, what is happening in the background. But depending from if something, okay, you can memorize it, you can remember something, having an idea. But if something is happening there, our reaction gives you the information of what is happening. So you can really perceive everything around, not because you are a magician or something special, just you have to pay a lot of attention to the signs. The signs that you see, and from the signs you see how things are working around. Then concentration. This, you know how are in athletics the high jumpers, the guys that are, have you ever seen? I suppose what they are doing. They don't just come there. They say, okay, now we're going to jump. No, and they stay there. All the time, you know, 3 or 5 minutes they have time. And this concentration they are taking, and they are repeating inside all the movements, they are getting the mood, the right mood to be so powerful to jump. And then they go, and in 2 seconds they jump. Can they think about meanwhile they are jumping, what I'm doing? Of course not. Everything was prepared before, in the concentration. So the same you have to make in research. You must be very, very concentrated in what you are doing, so that you don't need to think anymore. It is already everything there, you just cannot describe. Because if you start to describe, you're wasting time, you're losing the moment to give the answer. You must be so concentrated that the answer is immediately there. I know that I'm just making a list that sounds maybe a little, impossible, difficult, but I can tell you that we are making years long these practices and it works easily. Then we already said recognition, of course, this is the, you must have a knowledge, and then you must be patient, because mistakes, they will come and come and come and come. And you must be so patient to say, okay, I will continue anyway. Even if this is a real mistake, one of the billions of mistakes, okay, I will continue. And having a perseverance, not stopping in doing it. And then, three very important things that are typical of NisemTu method of research. When you are in these conditions, if you are hours, days long researching, trying to do something, then you start to put mistakes by yourself. You start to betray what you are doing and to say, now I'm making another way. I decided to this has to be around, now I make circular. Let's see what happens. Watching, observing it, I give answers to myself. I start a dialogue. I'm comparing the two things. So we were talking about using different stuffs, you know. You could have to make a dress, let's say, or something. And you decided to make it with silk and wool, let's say. Of some colors. Then you make the order, you pay the order, the material comes, and then you have silk and velvet, another color. And they will no more give you back the money, they will not send you, you have no more the money to buy something back, you have to invent something again. It is out, you have a precise idea. And then you say, okay, can I this idea apply anyway with these different steps? Or maybe not, it's impossible. This is a good answer to say no. This idea was precise, it was good in that way. Okay. But in another situation I can make another kind of dress. I can make books with this. I can make inside another system. Then something that close to finish, something that it's important always, not only in the group, and I can tell you by my experience as a gallerist and always also now, it is the most difficult thing to obtain. You must share, you must be generous. Everything you find, you must give to the others. Why this? Why this must? Not because I am of the idea that we must be good, gentle with others. No, 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 this is a productive. You should understand the principle of mafiosity. That is not mafia exactly, but mafiosity. What is mafiosity? If you go into a post office in Italy, for instance, I'm making just a sample, and you are a stranger, hardly understanding the other person, and the other person says, look, this is not possible to you. And you say, please, I'm a student, I'm coming from Ljubljana, this is really a problem for me, can you help me to solve it, and so on and so. 99% of cases, the person will try to solve it, and will solve it. And then you go, okay, everything good, and I ask you, why? Why this person made this? Will you come back? Never. So will you give something back? Never. So why? Because it's a Ubuntu principle. If you make a circle, something, if you will do the same with others, then something comes back. Always. So especially in creativity, artists and, or producers, creative persons are so jealous of what they produce. And this is letting them become blind to the results. If they share, they get ideas that is not copying the idea from the other, it is applying to your idea. And if you are copying something, this means it is not such original. Something really original is not possible to copy. You can be inspired. And finally, being elastic. Elastic, you must be, after 2 months you are seeking for something and you made 1 billion mistakes, 200,000 solutions and then something comes and you must say, okay, this is all to throw away. This is the right way. I have to change. You must be very available to change every moment, whatever you are doing. And the very last is being courageous. That looks something, you must be courageous. If you are making something that is so new, so different, you must defend it. Nobody will accept. And we were telling in the school, if you are putting a logic, argumentation to somebody, they will say, no, you have to do what I tell you. This is, I don't accept this. When you will be important, you will make your way, but now you have to do what they say. So when you are bringing something that is so powerful, the reaction, that is the same reaction if I throw you in face of board, you know? It's just something, I don't know how to deal with this. So I try to avoid it. So this is a very human and normal reaction. So you must be courageous to put a lot of grit inside. Finally, what happened to us, I hope that was not too quick and not too synthetic, but what happened to us? We were making this here, this workshop of identification. And again, I have a problem with this word. NisemTu is working on no reality. We consider, as a matter of fact, that nothing exists. as a reality. It is just a convention that we are applying. And this, every religion, as if every philosophy, every poet said this, we are not original at all. Just we are applying it. It is not just an attitude. So applying it, it's very useful for getting ways of being creative and to manage creativity and so on. And one way is to become, in English it said, identify with everything else that is not you. In NisemTu also with yourself, but this is the last step. Let's say I have to identify with this ball. So if, or I have to identify with you. So if I have, if I am the Nero, I start to sit in his way to be a little. So I will try to, with my hair to, so I will imitate him. But in Italian, this is identificazione, it is becoming him. But the right word is immedesimazione, that is, medesimo means self. We are the same thing. I don't need to imitate him because I am him and he is me. We are the same thing. We are made by the same matter, same. We are in this hour we exchange a lot of our molecules, so my molecules came inside you. Thank you for being part of your group now. And the same, and your group is inside me. So where is the distinction? So it is very difficult to say me, you, and so on. So when you understand that, and you feel that everything is you, it's no difference between you, this is immedesimazione. So the students, they were participating to the workshop, they decided to make a jingle for, as a product for this workshop, let's say. And they put the title of our workshop, our art identity, art reality identification. And especially one of the two knew perfectly English, and they both said art reality identification. And when I heard it, I said, oh fuck, I'm sorry for you, you worked 3 days long. But this is such a mistake, it's identification, not identity. But okay, it's not such important, let's put it apart. Okay. And then I was thinking, oh, this is applying serendipity. This mistake, I can use it, I can create a new word that is idemtification. Because idem, that is the same in English, is pronounced idem. So it's just sufficient that I change N with M and I will make art reality identification. And this will be finally solving 10 years long problem of this word that each time I have to explain how it is different in Italian and all in Italian from all other the languages, you know. So the solution came from the mistake, a solution to a problem. This is a stupid simple sample that can happen in everyday life. I stop here. I hope it was good or not.
It should be really hard to produce the serendipity because in its essence it is a thing that you shouldn't plan. So there's little point in giving it structure. It's mostly just...
You should be very open, you know? To be open, yes. You must, like the jumper, you must put inside all your ability, knowledge and so on, but then don't control anymore.
Yes,
you know?
Don't just
let go. Let's go.
So don't know.
But it's not such difficult. You know?
No, it's not. No,
it's
pretty easy. It happens all the time.
Yes, it happens always to everybody. Just we are making rules, you know, we are putting in order things that everybody is doing. It's not so. It happens to everybody. Choose better way instead.
So how would it be applied to a work environment?
In your case, when you have ideas, you have to intentions of doing some things. And then you must know all the environment, all the localization, mean not the environment, the room, all the what you are talking about, fashion or football team or what it is. All of you, as much as possible, and what you really are. Because what is not accepted, you know, if it's accepted by, it depends. If you want to be popular and rich, be tricky. But if you want to be important artist or fashion designer, be sincere.
What's an example of somebody that did like what you said, like a fake work in art, but it's, let's say, we know him and he's recognized, but you would say it's actually fake, or because I don't see that fake in how you describe it. It's not that bad.
It's how it's the only sound. Good. It's
yeah,
the only good.
It's still an art piece, and
it is the only possibility of an art piece to be an art piece is to be fake.
Yes, okay.
Because if it is true, the reality is
it's
a
bad,
copy.
It's
not art. It's not needed. Art is a language. Art is a way of communicating. It has some views, you know.
Yes, okay.
So we have to, like design and everything, we have to add somebody likes, somebody don't. This is not mandatory, but if you are inside the system of art, you must obey to these views. And the views are, look at every masterpiece. It's always blinking the eye and say, here is the trick. Mm-hmm. Or making some, I don't know, resurrection of Piero della Francesca. There is half of the, in the background, there is this Jesus Christ that is like a mountain. And all the scene is, of course, him and the people sleeping down. It is really like a mountain. But then you look at the background. In the background, half is winter, half is summer. And Mrs. Mojca Novak here would say, oh, but how stupid he was. It was winter or summer. He was not able to paint the background. But he wanted to say, okay, this is death and new life, you know? So it is the symbology of resurrection. And it is full of these details, full. And every painting has these details that are just blinking the eye to say, look, this is the way. And this is making it fake, you know? It is not reality, reproduced reality, but fake. Or even, you know, Lily Brick, this famous Kingi from Rochenko, the advertisement for the woman with the hand. So, but have you ever seen the picture, the original picture?
Okay.
He made a portrait of his best friend's wife, that was Lily Brick, and she's in this position, she's watching straight, and there are much more of the court, and then he turned, he cut, and he made the portrait. So he made a choice, you know, cutting, turning, you are making an intervention, it is no more the reality. It is no more a copy, it is what I am putting of myself inside this. Then you can copy, you can make a force, you can copy and say me, look, this is a real Michelangelo by it, okay? And of course this is not acceptable, but if you're making a copy and blinking, then becomes fake, you know? So it is can also be made. Mike Beadle, Sherry Levine, and many artists were making copies, but showing you that were copies, so okay, it's made by me. And then if you are making very, very bad, it is very common. The Emmaus dinner in Rotterdam's museum, Göring was convinced to keep this painting as one of the most important Vermeer and so on. And by case, I've seen it coming out from the library, which was in a corridor. I've seen, oh, some student, bad student, tried to make again the copy of Emma's dinner. I said, but this is a little strange. I came back, and this was the painting. This was the copy. It was so bad made that just passing in this way, I said, oh, some bad student. How could it be possible that somebody has seen a masterpiece in this? It was his intention to see it. He was compelled to see. You see what you want to see. Huh? And this is important also for you. You know, when you are producing something, be careful. You must consider not me, not the final destination, but humanity. How humanity is made. It is made like you. So it is not showing what you see, but what everybody sees. And these are emotions. You have to represent emotions through colors, through shapes, through whatever you want. Music. Music is the easiest to show how emotions is possible to be reproduced in art. You know? Too many doubts, I know. It's okay?
Yeah, maybe somebody would like to share some experience with Serendipity or some mistakes you had.
No, most of
have you any mistakes?
I think always. It's just that. It's the most common way I make stuff. I just wait. Sometimes I just wait. Because I know it's there somewhere, the answer. There's no like specific way to get there. If I knew the way, you know, I would just do that way every time. Just get there. So the hardest part is just to.
Yeah, this is correct. There is something. I don't want really to say it too much because it's already too much. But the distinction between contemplation and meditation is important for you. So when you are in front of white mountains or a nice landscape or sunset on the sea, you know, you're just there, you know, and you are contemplating it. There is no thinking, just watching it. Then you can start to think. Because, oh, who we are, where we are going, so you can start to with all your thoughts about, no? But this is meditation, inspired by the contemplation. So the position to get this way of talking with the ego sapiens is being just into contemplation. With, as you said, I made something I don't know. I know that the answer is there. Yes, I'm just contemplating it without trying to give interpretations to the intentions and so on. Just waiting the comes. But it doesn't come because of his power, but because of your power that you are in condition to get it. Because if you are, you just broke with your girlfriend and you decide to go to the sea to relax, but along the way you got 3 fish from the police and then you killed a baby and you escaped from this, and you are not such in front of the seaside, you are not such in a condition that, oh, wow, beautiful it is. Of course, you must be in the condition to get to listen to the answer. Ego sapiens is talking to us through signs. You know that Central American Indians, the Indians, they didn't see the ships of the Spanish people. They were blind. Galleons were there, and they were not seeing them because they had no recognition. They never seen something like that. They couldn't figure out this. It was, if you have not inside yourself, you don't see it. And this is very common to us. Tens of times per day, to everybody of us, we don't see things just because we don't recognize. Then there was some shaman, probably this is the hypothesis, that have seen the signs and seen that the waves on the strand were a little different from what they had to be, that there was a head going in the sea, that there was something around, And then they combined, deducted that something had to be there. And they have seen, and then they could say to the others, look, it looks like a horse is not a horse, it is, and so starting to describe it, and then everybody could see it. So that you have to talk like the shaman, watching the signs, watching the emotions are coming out, watching the reactions you have, but very pure, before being angry, ashamed, or happy, or pleased, or so on. Just in this point, catching it in this point, putting yourself in meditation, in contemplation in this point. This is said in this way, I tell you, has no sense. It has sense to practice, as I told you. Just try to put it there, leave it there, but give a glance sometimes and think to other things, and then something comes, if it has a value.
But sometimes you think you didn't do anything. Like you think, from the last time I was dealing with some problem until now, I haven't done anything or didn't think about it, but still you find some new answers. I think that's a part of it.
That was not what you were expecting.
Yes.
This is serendipity. Yes. You didn't find India, but America.
Yeah, no, but if you didn't even... like you didn't do any work in between the last two, I don't know, maybe like when you trying to solve the problem, but there's still something that you something new there.
This is a matter that is very interesting. And now finally, the neuro psychologist, they turn 180 degrees the point of view of people with mental diseases, how to approach them. Because till now it was said they are, for instance, Idiosawam, you know, like Rain Man, you know the movie?
Yes.
He was able to 254. So how can you do this? You have something more. No, they have something less. For instance, there is today is one of the most famous Dio Savan. The Dio is no more said, now they are called only Savan. He is able, he's brought on London, Rome, Tokyo for 2 hours with helicopter, and then in 2 days he makes a 16 meters drawing. It is perfect. Every window, every tree, everything. Practically no mistake. And so the normal approach till recently was he has something more, he can memorize more. And now it is very simple to understand. No, he has something less. He is reading things as we were reading things when we were learning to read, letter by letter. Now we read all the phrase, jumping through the words, and finding the meaning of the thing. He is not looking to any meaning. He's not jumping through the words. He's just reading letter by letter and memorizing. And so this is just one of the many samples that can be made of these people, autistic people, and of savan people, and so on. They have nothing different from us. What I mean? There is one guy that is not autistic, not a savan. He is from Czechia, I suppose. You can put him a very hard calculation, really. Numbers multiplicated by other numbers and so on. Something impossible. Even a computer takes a lot of time, to hours, to give the answer, no? And you give him the problem, okay, this is the problem. And then he works, he is continuing working and so on. After months, weeks, months, he gives you the answer. And investigating how it was working, he's never thinking. His brain is thinking somewhere to the solution and is producing the right answer. So again, this is an ability that everybody has, you know. Just we are not, don't know how to manage them, how to use them. And normally we have too much. It is like the other guy. If, we have to lose something to have these kind of abilities that are also useless, finally. The ability of making a heavy, complicated, articulated construction is something, and having ideas and so on, it is something much more of advantage for us. But this doesn't mean that we have not these abilities. So, as far as I understand, the sample you were making, it works in this way. I have there, and I'm making my things. I'm not thinking to it. And less I think to it, better it is. But somewhere, because I see it, it is there somehow. You know, this number I told you, this was just the photons, you know? But consider, all your senses are reaching every data that is coming in this moment from wherever, from Ljubljana, from wherever. Are billions and billions and billions and billions of data that are coming, and you are elaborating, producing this. And why? Because you just need to know that you are safe, warm enough, no danger. So this is the answer that brain is giving. And if you have not this answer, brain is reacting, letting you move. There is a scientist that is saying that the only use of brain is let us move. It is not so stupid, because we react. So, let's be easy, you know. Now I'm feeling you with all these words. But on the contrary, the practice is extremely easy. Just, you have not to think to all these things. You have just to,
yes, but
to
sometimes
be very spontaneous.
Not to think, it's very, I mean, it can be very hard.
Of course.
Because, for example, I will look at the mistakes different way from today on, because I never liked mistakes. I always try, whenever I work, I try to not do a mistake, because I don't know, I'm afraid of them. Yeah, so I always, whatever I start to do,
we were taught to do this.
Yeah, I'm doing it so slowly and so nicely, so everything has to be like perfect and nice and clean. So doing stuff like leave it there and just look at it and wait for the simple, I mean, you know, for something to happen, I don't know, for me it's hard. I will try now, I will do some mistakes on purpose, but I'm sure it will be hard, because I like to feel the control.
Be quick, don't be slow. You don't have not to put mistakes in tension. Be quick, right quick.
Also, it's not a point to make a mistake. It's a point to recognize a mistake and to
in
move.
Something,
and to change it something.
It's possible, because in many cases it is just a mistake.
To upgrade, to make something new, you know? This is the point, not to make. If you say, if I set down, okay, you have homework, you have to make a mistake. It will be something completely different. It's not the right way, you know. This recognition, Andrea mentioned, you know? We constantly make mistakes, but some mistakes are bad and some are also good. And how to divide, you know, how to recognize good from the bad mistakes and how to upgrade good mistakes, you know. Because also many times when students bring to me some work and they say, oh, this I made a mistake, this should be like this, and say, but this is much better what it should be, you know. So how to recognize, and this is the knowledge, you know, if you have a good knowledge, a good bunch of experiences, you can recognize and upgrade. This is the point, not to make, because then you lose energy, because you have to think, oh, which kind of mistakes I should make?
Of course,
how
then
to
it's
challenge
again,
yourself.
Yeah.
Not
this
is
way.
It's again
the same. Yeah.
Maybe there is a fear or less self-confidence, discipline, the thing you expect from yourself to do, and between to recognize the mistake, which is probably better than your finish goal. I think
probably is, because as much you have things under control, less sincere you are. It is correct.
Yeah.
but Elliot. But it's not you. And I need you, you know? Not you, because I see, I don't know you. I know your product. But through your product, I know myself, you know? Because you put yourself inside. This is how art works, but everything. Also, a contract of a lawyer, you know, it's the same kind of creation. You understand better if he's putting himself inside. But of course, this is so funny. We were taught at least 13 years or more, and all the lifelong, all the system is teaching, telling you, don't mistake. So it's difficult. But if you are creative, you must mistake. So you have your problem. Are you happy? I can also put this so you can.
Yeah. So maybe somebody would like to share some experiences or something.
Have you any mistake here?
Well, with me it's like this. Whenever I start doing some new project, like a new collection, for example, when I go in research, when I start research, I'm sure that I'm doing what I like. For example, I don't know, my diploma work, I was sure that I was doing something I like, because, I don't know, first time I had really the chance to choose the team by myself to do whatever I wanted, so I was sure that that's something I really like, that's like my style or my fashion. But meanwhile, in the process of researching, I actually find out that that I don't like it that much that I thought in the first place. So after every research, I think I'm closer to the real style or real fashion I really like, because after every research I did till now, it showed me that the things that I didn't like, I start like more, and the things that I was sure that I like, I stopped liking so much, because at one point I didn't know what to do with them, because they were so nice like they were, and when I did the research I wasn't sure anymore that I like that, because I guess I changed them that much. So that's one.
Yeah, we are never satisfied, of course, of our results, because you know everything is inside our mind. There is much more universe inside your mind than out from your mind. Everything has to be recognized. So you have images of everything in your mind, even things that you have never seen, but you have the image. And for image, I mean something very based, also ideas, logic, combinations, and so on. So when you produce, of course, you are putting out your emotions, what you are, some of your knowledge, of course, must be used to make it fake. It must be intentional somehow. But then when you have the result, of course you watch it and automatically say, it's not what I had inside.
Yeah.
But you will never be able to paint this because you cannot see it.
Of course.
You can see the signs. So you can represent it. You can make what it's emissions that is you, your emissions. But this is good, no? Because otherwise you make one thing in life and then it's okay.
It could be okay. So,
to play poker.
Well, I think that's the one of the reasons why, I don't know, someone designs more and more and more, because you're searching that one image that you, or that one style that you think it's you. And
it's called, in Italian, it's called coazione ripetere. It's a term that is used in art, in a critic, or art critic. Coazione is compelled, being compelled to repeat. You cannot avoid to repeat. Maybe change it, but it is always the same. But look, our life, we are always the same. You are not different from what you were 3 months old, you are not different from what you were 8 years old. Of course, your body, your consequently some actions will be different. You now you are no more so depending by someone that is helping you to feed. But what you have inside, it's always the same. Nothing changes. Your character, your personality is that. And you are, so you are just through the years expressing it in different ways. You know? But again, it is in art especially, but in every in everything, in every creative thing, it is dangerous to express what you know. You must express how you feel, not what you feel, but how you feel, your emotions.
But without recognizing that, because I hate this, like, oh, now I'm going to, I'm angry, I'll do something angry-ish.
As in, angriness, you know, is already a product.
Yeah, this is, yeah, exactly. So not really being aware that you're angry, no. Just, you know. Yes.
I have no formula, you know, because this is totally a black hole, you know, so it's, there is not, I can't describe, so many, we found 112 different feelings that we can describe. Feelings are consequences of emotions, but we cannot describe emotions. The emotions you can only represent through something that is giving me something that I also recognize. So not angriness. Angriness is a feeling. And in English, emotion is a wrong word. You know? Emotions are before. So it's, English is a horrible language. Yeah, really, it's making a lot of difficulties. When you know Latin, Latin is opening your everything. Yeah. Agree, you know, agree. What, do you agree with me? Okay. Consider, say d'accordo. D'accordo, bling, so it comes from music. Are you on the same melody?
Uh-huh.
And you understand perfectly what means do you agree. You know? Uh-huh. So I can make you hundreds of samples of this. It is not because I'm Italian, but I'm grateful that I learned Italian because it's Latin especially because it helped me so much to understand things. Recognition is the main word. And also, I was telling you that we are all the same. This is, I will just make it extremely short, this should take 3 days. But there are no limits between us, you know? But we are delimiting, saying I, you, I delimiting you and me, or defining you and me, you know? But delimiting with English you can understand, I'm putting a limit, but the